Hi there, model train enthusiasts. I believe this is what is known as the selfie, where you hold the camera up and photograph or film yourself. It's vanity in the extreme, I suppose. But I'm doing this because in recent days I've had quite a few emails come in asking me if there's any way I'm going to be filming anything more on the layout. The general answer has been no, I've nothing else to film. I think you've seen it all. But then I realised I'd actually got some six-wheeled coaches from the Darstead range which haven't even been run on here, let alone filmed. So that kind of answered that. And then again I've had another one this morning asking me exactly the same, how has the layout fared throughout the winter. This is something that's been asked numerous times over the, I don't know, 3 or 4 years this layout's been in the garden here. And so I thought this would be a wonderful way, especially on such a bright sunny day as we've got today, to come out and just to show you exactly what running a garden railway entails. And the layout that you can probably see around me here is exactly as it appears, apart from the mug of tea that's popped up, is exactly how it has fared after 6 months of, well, standing here in the garden all winter long. So moving a bit closer, you can see the bits of debris, the leaves, and more importantly, you should see the tarnish on the tops of the rails, which, if it's not removed, will certainly prevent anything from running on here properly. We have the damage to the trees which normally stand here around and about, bits of hedge that have come off. And the reason why this happens on my particular layout and on this particular area, which if you look very closely you can see has got bits of fluff on here, and it's distinctly flattened. And the reason why is because our neighbourhood cats, absolutely, one in particular, absolutely love to come and sit on this, because it's in the sun, it's very warm with polystyrene being underneath it, it's nice and flat, and they love it, and they can spend hours on here. So that's a very real pitfall of an outdoor railway layout if you're not careful. Do you have local cats, and are they likely to be interested in the railway, and if so, are they likely to damage it? But if we just take a walk around the line, you'll see the general debris that there is that's got to be either put up with or removed, depending on how particular you want to be about the condition of the layout. Certainly I'll brush some of this off. The other thing I'm often asked is, how do these canopy stations fare out of doors? Well, this is a pair of the four that I've got. Those that know me know how I set about replacing the tin plate parts with aluminium parts, the platforms, the canopies. But the rest of the structure is the cast aluminium structure of the original, the glass. The top roof was replaced in aluminium, and then the whole thing was held together with numerous small brass nuts and bolts in place of the original metal ones, which would have certainly rusted by now. And what you see is what you get. This has been standing out here in the garden now for probably 4 years, I lose track. And at any time I could take all of this aluminium, or these aluminium components, take them off, replace with the original bright shiny tin plate, which is obviously in storage, and frankly I don't think you would ever know that the main structure and the glass and the acrylic had been out in the garden for all these years. And at times during those years it's been completely buried in ice and snow, it's been wet for days on end, tremendous heat at times, but I'm satisfied that it's doing no detrimental harm to the core structure of the building. So that's what the layout looks like today, right now, in this rather nice early spring day in March 2014. And I'm going to set about preparing the outer line to take a train around, and you should be able to see yourself how this particular layout copes in the British winters. Okay, well, here is another top tip for keeping on top of the line. It's something you wouldn't normally want to broadcast, and I do it purely for the benefit of this little film that's being put together. But if it's really nice and dry, which it is right now, one of the best ways to deal with all the leaves and the small debris that you've got on the line is the Hoover. As I say, you don't broadcast the fact that you're doing this, chaps, but it makes a cracking job, as you will see. Okay, well, there you have it. Top tip, use the Hoover on the garden railway to get rid of the leaves and the debris. And it certainly does a much quicker and easier job than just simply using the hand brush. The only thing is, you just don't admit to what you've just done with the Hoover. And you'll see around this section here, which was particularly thick, and in my case it's always in the shade here, so all of the leaves and debris are very damp all the time. It still nevertheless cleans it up quite nicely. Just keep regularly emptying the collecting box, or whatever you call it. So now I might just find the time to start to clean the track. Now, the essential ingredient for being able to clean the track, in my personal opinion, are surgical gloves. It is a dirty job which will stain your hands very quickly, and they'll become quite difficult to clean. So get yourself some of these disposable gloves, and I use a track rubber, which in this instance and generally is made by the company that are known as Gauge Master. And what we have to do with the rubber is rub the track so that the brown tarnish is turned into bright shiny nickel silver, like so. And you should see that in those few moments we've gone from being brown and tarnished to bright and shiny. And unless, in my experience, unless this track is as bright and clean as that all over, it simply will not work, no matter what I do. So I spent about a half an hour hoovering off the leaves, which is a good job well done, because it shouldn't really be necessary to do it again now for the rest of the year. And I know from experience there's about another half an hour's amount of work in going round all of the track, probably more like about 40 minutes if I was to do both circuits. But I'll put the watch on, the timer on, and we'll see how long it takes. Now, what I've decided to do is I've just started cleaning, as you've seen in the last clip, on this bit of a curve here, and I've been round for about the past 5 minutes to a point behind me, and I've stopped deliberately, and then I've put these new six-wheeler coaches on, and the only locomotive I've got really that is suitable to pull them, the little LMS Jinty. I put the power pack on behind me, the controller, and I've briefly just tested it to make sure that the train is going in the right direction, and the first thing it's told me is it's going to work and it's going forward, so there's no embarrassment by it suddenly going backwards. And what I've done is the cleaning process of the track goes all the way around here into this curve, and then it just stops abruptly, because I thought it'd be interesting for you to see how a locomotive copes when it gets to one of these heavily tarnished sections of track. So here comes the power, let's see what happens. And anything could, because as I say, these coaches have not been lubricated, their axles, they're literally out of the box, and away it goes. Now let's see what happens as it comes into this curve. There you go, you can see exactly what I mean, and in fact it comes to a standstill. So here again is the locomotive on its own going straight into this uncleaned section of track. And again, it grinds to a halt simply because there's no what I call connectivity between the track and the wheels of the locomotive, or the connectivity is so poor that it just can't find sufficient current to run, and indeed it stops. Now what I'll try and do is explain, possibly with a couple of photographs, how in addition to keeping the track running surface clean, every bit as important, if not more so, is how on earth you preserve the connection from one section of rail to another via the fish plates here. There are various techniques used by different modellers. Trust me, I looked for the simplest, and as far as I'm concerned, it's worked very well, which I'll try and explain in a little bit more detail. Now I feel sure you'll see, having cleaned the curve all the way around the back there, you'll see that the locomotive will now go quite merrily along this piece of track, even at a steady speed, without any real hesitation at all. So I'll just stop her there, because I've still got plenty more to do. Just one little thing I'll point out. Notice finger end, probably not in focus, I can't tell, but made use of the Gauge Master rubber with my left hand just to do that section of track, and lo and behold, got that smudgy mark all over it, which I can assure you will take some washing off. It's quite a stubborn sort of stain that it gives, which is why I say these surgical gloves, disposable gloves, are essential. Very briefly, here's another top tip. I've had to break off to have a bit of lunch. You can't keep going at this sort of work all day long without something to eat. And I refuse to give up on disposable gloves until they've disintegrated, which is mine is trying to do. But whether they disintegrate or not, you can't put them on for a second time without some talcum powder. Top tip, remember you saw it here. So here you have it. You'll see just coming into shot is an oil can. This contains clean engine oil from the car, and I unashamedly make use of that to lubricate, or have used it to lubricate, these six wheel coaches, which have got a degree of mechanics going on underneath them, with sliding axles and various pivots from the hooks and the axles. So they're all now lubricated. Personally, I'd much rather have too much than too little. And this layout has been cleaned up, as you've observed, for the first time in 6 months. It's had the power and the controller applied to it. and the engine is performing with coaches straight out of the box and a bit of lubrication, as you can see. The main thing really about today, as regards being a day suitable to do this, is that it's dry. It's not particularly warm quite now. This property is going into the shade. We are situated directly under a railway embankment. You can see the viaduct, and that's the embankment. So we are in the shade a lot of the time here. And all of this side of the layout that the train is now going along was damp during the course of today when I was hoovering the leaves up, etc. But that apart, the rails are dry, and that's actually crucial in my opinion to stand a chance of running any of these little trains in a garden layout. As soon as it goes damp, it starts to adversely affect the connectivity of the current between the track that's going around it and trying to make contact through the wheels of the loco with the motor. You get it on a dry day like now, and really they're great fun. So there you have her. She's been going around merrily for about 10 minutes or so. Still performing quite nicely, and I shall be shutting her down and putting her to bed shortly, which brings us on to another point, because if tomorrow I wanted to bring this out and run it again, even if it stays bone dry overnight, the air, the moisture in the air is likely to be such that there will be an element of tarnish on those rail surfaces once again. Obviously only slight compared to what I've just taken off after 6 months, but even that slight film or tarnish could adversely affect the performance, and in all probability I would probably go very quickly over the whole lot again just to make sure that it would give me trouble pre-running, as it's obviously doing now. So there you go, and there she goes.